A couple years back, my buddies and I tried to stay in the park after closing time. Our plan was just to take pictures. Nothing sinister. We just wanted to be able to say we did it, you know? Basically, we snuck from bathroom to bathroom, corner to corner, and managed to stay unseen until they closed the gates and the maintenance team got to work. We were really surprised we hadn't gotten caught. It was almost strange considering how much talking up Disney security gets. Our hearts were beating like crazy, and we sat there for a while, hiding behind a tombstone by the Haunted Mansion. We noticed that it's true. The Disney staff had signed their names on every single one. So finally, we got the courage to roam about, still being careful as to not be seen. It really was eerie. The occasional guard or maintenance worker, they'd just walk by, and we would duck or hide behind a corner. I mean, it worked for about half an hour. Of course, we couldn't keep this up for long. And yeah, they caught us. I mean, give us props for even attempting and succeeding. But that's not where the story ends. The first thing we said when we got caught was, "Are you gonna take us down to the dungeon?" And we laughed. The security guard chuckled too, so the mood wasn't too dreary. He told us we weren't the first people to try to sneak in after hours, but he wanted to know how we did it. We explained the situation and he actually laughed. He said that wasn't a bad plan. He told us he had to take us to the Disney jail to be further interrogated. We figured from the beginning that if we'd gotten caught, that's where they'd take us. I mean, it was our plan all along. We wanted to see the Disney catacombs, more than we wanted to be in the park after hours. So we called for more workers to come and help him escort us, and we went on our way towards Toontown. Then they took us down in this elevator, right into hell. The first thing we noticed was how expensive looking the elevator was. I don't know if that makes sense, but it's hard to explain. It was like a stainless steel interior, with the mirrors all around, and the floor was this tacky red carpeting. But it looked expensive. There were only two buttons in this elevator. One said up, the other said down. They never handcuffed us or zip-tied our hands. They just kind of walked beside us, expecting we'd follow. Not that we would have tried to run for it, I mean, these people seem decent. And how are we supposed to know what was going to happen? The elevator stopped and we started walking down this perfectly shining, bleach-smelling corridor. There were no doors on either side. It was just a plain, empty corridor. We walked for what seemed like an eternity, and no one was talking any longer. It was me, my friends, the security guard, and two other maintenance workers. Finally, we reached a heavy metal door that had a security card and code reader. One worker put his card in, and the other typed a code on the keypad. I watched the code he typed in. 121566. I have a thing for numbers. And I found out later that it actually had significance. And it makes me laugh. Looking back, strange. It's strange that I could laugh looking back. And they led me and my friends into another corridor. This one had doors down the hallway walls. Each door had a little plexiglass square, 10 by 10 inch window, in the top right corner. It looked sort of like a psych ward, to be honest. Not so much like a jail. He led us to room 1901, and inside was a single desk, with surprisingly three chairs for me and each of my friends. Then they left us in there alone. Closing the door on the way out, we sat in the chairs like obedient little children and waited for them to return. But they never did. 2 hours went by and no one came back for us. My buddy Tim went to the door and surprisingly it was unlocked. He didn't open it though. I guess he was worried that there would be a guard on the outside and that they'd think we were escaping and we weren't looking for any more trouble. So about 25 minutes went by when we got restless and finally decided to leave the room. The hallway was empty. Like before, no signs of people, nothing. We started calling out, "Hello? Is anybody there?" No one answered our calls. We noticed surveillance cameras were placed above every door, and we got to wondering if there was any living soul in this place at all. We should have left right then and there. But then again, who does the right thing when they're in these kinds of situations? You don't think straight. Every door looked the same, and each one had a specific number above it. They weren't in any order like rooms 1 through 10. They were scattered numbers. For example, our room had been 1901, but the door next to it was 1205. I got to thinking and finally assumed that they were just randomly chosen. We walked up that hallway and had no idea where we were going, what we were hoping to find, or even if it mattered. My other buddy Danny decided we should just leave. He said that if they really wanted us here, they'd have come back. And maybe it was just a scare tactic. Maybe they just wanted to trick us into thinking we were being arrested and were waiting for us outside to have a laugh. I felt wary of the whole situation, and Tim was just quiet the whole time, nodding his head here and there, not really doing anything. He was more interested in looking into the doors, those little 10 by 10 inch windows. That wasn't a good idea. I tried to tell him, but of course, no one listens to reason when they're freaked out. And we were definitely freaked the fuck out at this point. The cameras above the doors were capable of motion detection and followed us as we wandered through the desolate corridor, a little red light at the bottom of the lens blinking each second. No noise filled the air. All we heard was each other breathing. Then it happened. We had reached the end of the hallway. Unfortunately, the door at the end had another pin code reader. I tried the pin from before, the one I saw them type in, but it was invalid. At this moment, the lights in the hallway shut off and we heard the doors. I can still hear them to this day. Those fucking doors opened. All lining up along the corridor, they made this creak and whoosh sound, and then a boom as they hit the wall beside them with such force. As I said, after I entered the invalid code into the keypad, the lights shut off and the doors opened, except for the door with the keypad. Each doorway had a little bit of light seeping from its open pathway. We stood there, stunned for a good 5 minutes, not knowing what to do. We figured we'd trip some alarm and that this was just protocol, a standard drill, in case of an attempted escape. Stupid. So fucking stupid. But what were we supposed to think? We turned the other direction, away from the locked door. A sense of panic hit all three of us for some reason, and we got the urge to run. No one agreed to running. It was like we all just knew we had to, at the same time. Some sort of instinct, I guess. Like a baby gazelle knowing when to run from a lion. It wasn't until about the 10th door we passed that I began to look into the doorways as we passed them. Standing in the doorways were people in costume. We were running past Donalds and Mickeys and Goofies and Plutos and all different kinds of Disney characters. It was insane, and we screamed at the top of our lungs. I know they say never look back behind you as you run, but I did. They were leaving their rooms and following us, not running, just walking towards us. I think that it made it that much more terrifying. Almost like they knew we had nowhere to go. Now, I don't know if it was all in my head, just from sheer panic and fear of the moment, but I swear on my mother's life, I heard It's a Small World playing over an intercom. I have a fear of dolls. I always have. I mean, I know it's stupid for a girl to be afraid of dolls, but whatever. And the ride always gave me the creeps, my whole life. And now I could see them. The little robotic dolls standing in the doorways as we passed, still following where the costume characters. But the dolls weren't chasing us, thank God. I would have died from a heart attack if I had seen the dolls following suit. But they didn't. It didn't make any sense. It didn't make the situation all that better. I mean, how many times have you been followed by a group of costumed individuals seemingly out to fucking eat you alive? Or at least that's what I told myself to keep myself moving. Stopping meant being devoured by fucking Donald Duck. Tim was crying, and Danny was sweating and breathing heavily, and I just kept turning my head to see if we were being followed. And of course we were. I'm not sure how many doors we had passed at this point, or if there really were different characters at each door, but I knew that this hallway had to end at some point, and we were getting the fuck out of this place. But that was easier said than done. I looked back after another minute or two of running and noticed there was nothing behind us anymore that I could see. I heard footsteps, but figured we had gotten so far ahead that they were just still walking like before. The hallway was still going on for what seemed like forever, and Danny needed to stop, or he was going to faint from exhaustion. The door beside us was open, with the light on, but nothing was inside. Thank God nothing was inside. I decided we should hide in there until we caught our breath and could continue forward. As we closed the door behind us, I noticed the room was 1966. Again, you know, the number thing. It meant nothing at this time. I should have known. Tim was pacing the room. Danny was lying on the floor, still breathing pretty hard. And I was at the window looking out. I saw nothing. There was no more music. Nothing. It was dark and hard to tell for sure, but I figured I would have seen figures, shadows, or something. Still, I kept watch. After 15 minutes or so, Danny said he was good to go. Tim was the only one smart enough to pull out his cell. There's no signal. Of course. He opened the door quietly and heard no footsteps. Nothing was following us anymore. But we weren't taking chances. We got back to running. It took us forever to reach the door. It had no keypad and it was open. We entered the corridor from before and thank God there were no doors. We ran for the elevator and got in, pushed the up button, and stood there. We stood there just looking at each other dumbfounded as to what had just happened. None of us spoke. We just waited until the elevator opened back into Toontown and started making our way to the front gate. We kept a low profile using the same duck and hide technique that had gotten us this far from the start. Maintenance workers and security guards were still about, but we couldn't take any more chances. Finally, Tim lost it and took off in a sprint. I couldn't fucking imagine what had set him off until I looked and saw that everyone in the park just stood there, staring at us with blank faces. We heard a voice over the intercom explaining that three fugitives had escaped from captivity and needed to be escorted back into the jails below. Danny and I booked it. We caught up to Tim in no time. Costume characters appeared from the shadows, workers and guards chasing after us. Everyone was sprinting for us, and I couldn't see well, but I imagined drool dripping from their jowls as they wanted us back down there. We'd escaped, and they were pissed. The gate was just up ahead. The creepiest thing about it all was that besides the voiceover from the intercom, the park was dead silent as we were running for what we assumed was our lives. From the characters, the workers, the guards, no one bothered to shout after us. No one yelled, no one said stop, hey you, nothing. Just footsteps and the occasional cough from Danny. As we made it past the park's front gate, we didn't stop until we got to the parking lot. The car was gone. It didn't matter though. We just continued running down the road, which went on for miles, stopping occasionally to catch our breath. We made it to a little corner store where Tim used his cell to call a taxi cab. When it finally arrived, we took the cab back to the hotel, paid the fare, and went up to our rooms. In the end, the next day, we got a call from the hotel's front desk, so we headed downstairs. There were officers waiting for us. They said our car had been impounded and we needed to pay the fine. They didn't ask us any questions. We didn't bother telling the police anything that had happened. We didn't bother. We simply paid the fine and drove home. We didn't talk about what happened the whole drive back. It wasn't until a couple of weeks later that I got myself to search up the numbers. It was curiosity, I guess. That's when I found it. I mean, as you all know, Walt Disney was born December 5th, 1901. The room we were in was 1901, and the door next to it was 1205. Also, he died December 15th, 1966, which was the key code the worker had put in to lead us from the main corridor. Whether any of this is real at all, I couldn't tell you. Maybe our imaginations ran wild. I mean, we were tired. It was around 1 a.m. when we made our escape. I'll never forget it, though. The numbers are just a coincidence. We were just tired.